Thank you, Peter. So, we can take some... Oh, you can stay, yeah? Okay. So, we can take some questions, because also Gabriela Petre from the National Vet Center of Romania is sick, so she can make it. So that means that Peter will be in this session the only speaker. But, first of all, maybe a very critical question is, on one hand, you were saying at the end, yeah, it's on a case-by-case basis, but when I saw your slides on the number of non-compliance cases and dysfunctions, and we are talking here about new dwellings. So the figures I read on your slide, 1,287 new dwellings and 1,247 non-compliances and dysfunctions. This is more than case by case.
What I mean by case, you have to think of residential ventilation as one case. So in the specific context of ventilation, do you think it's enough to invest in training, making people competent, or do you have to think of third-party control? So it's not, of course, one building, you should do it, and the other not. But on the other hand, for example, take of mold problems in buildings, I think there you might say we don't have to think of third-party control, because if a designer, an architect, a contractor is aware of the risk, and if he has the competence, the probability that he will do it correctly is large. So that I mean by case is not by building, but by kind of technology. Mm-hmm. But I think clearly, because as in all sectors, but also in the building sector, by definition, the building sector is not asking for a lot of control. So you should really justify why is it needed, why is it a help for the sector and not a threat of the sector. I think that's very important. You should show the added value. It should be proportional. It should really help the sector and help society.
Yeah. I will come back on it, but maybe are there some questions in the room? Yeah, Peter.
Well, you remember when we were very young, so 20 years ago, we had exactly the same discussions in the numerous projects. I mentioned TIPVENT, ResiVENT. And also the numbers of non-compliances were at the time pretty much the same as now. So what have we been doing all these 20 years? And a second question is, are there any indications that we can improve now really this situation? Because I didn't see so much improvement over all these years.
Well, I think that in a number of areas, I really believe we see improvements. For example, in certain countries on renewable energies, I think there is really improvement in the competence and also in the quality of the works. If I again refer to, for example, ventilation, air tightness, we see in a number of countries really substantial steps forward. It takes time, it's clear, it's not going very quickly. And I think also because creating the societal support for quality checks, controls, and the possibility of sanctions is not evident. So you really have to, I think, first of all, to show there is a problem. So the situation on the ground to make sure, don't understand it works well. I think also showing, you know, it's possible to do it better in a pragmatic way and let's say proportional with the problem. It takes time, but I think we have a number of examples showing that it can work. Take, for example, the Swedish approach with air tightness. I think it has helped in a lot of other countries. Yes, we can do it. But it takes time. Indeed, it goes quite slowly. But if I see, for example, in our own country, in Belgium, we see, I think, for example, in air tightness, in cavity wall insulation, a very substantial increase of the quality of the works. If I look to the UK, for example, for also cavity wall, I think they have several millions of houses done in a quality framework. So it is possible, but at the same time, as you say, it takes time. And it's a continuous, I would say, struggle to really keep the societal support for control on site.
And it's true that also, as most people know, it's becoming more complex. But on the other hand, if you look at the legislation, the EPPD, the first EPPD was written in 2001. It took 8 years before the member states have transposed into national legislation. So it's an understatement if we say it's going slow. Mm-hmm. So and we also have seen by doing a lot of interviews with the construction sector that the solutions will not come often bottom up. Mm-hmm. And there should be some push forward top-down from national governments or regional governments.
Yeah. And but there I think it's an end story. You can say a sector, it has to come from politics, but I think it's clear for politics imposing requirements which are not supported by lead stakeholders is very difficult. Mm. So I think you have to, on the one hand, I would say really get support among the stakeholders. I think of contractors, architects, investors, that they see the benefit of putting requirements. And then I think it's much more easier for at policy level to impose this kind of requirements. So it's not, I think it's indeed, it's a number of cases, and I think ventilation for me is a good example. Even if you are as a contractor very motivated, we hear from a number of contractors, you know, if I do what I should do, I am too expensive. So create me the boundary conditions that I can deliver good quality of the works. And so I think if you can then go to policymakers and say, you know, the sector itself asks a more effective control, it can work. But you cannot expect from a politician, I will do it if it is against the sector. I think that's very, very difficult. Okay.
And do you see then some solutions? Because there are some positive cases. Eh? I'm also thinking, for example, at Luxembourg, where on renewable energies, it's one of the first countries that have set up an association dealing with certificates. And so the Renewable Energy Association in Luxembourg received from the government the authority to set up a certification scheme. And nowadays, a big majority of all renewable energy installers in Luxembourg are certified. How is it possible that this will be done in most of the member states of most of the regions?
I think it's, to my sense, always this combination of having information on the situation of the ground, having an indication of these are ways to go forward, and then to, let's say, convince policymakers or organizations to do it. Take, for example, the cavity wall insulation example. It's clear, I think, for everybody in the sector, it is a technology with a certain risk. If you don't do it correctly, you may have mold problems and others. So if you want to have a sustainable long-term market, I think the sector understands we should get rid of the cowboys. Those who don't do it well will, I would say, destroy the sector. And so I think that has helped to, within the sector and then at policy level, yes, we should come to minimum requirements. And that, of course, creates then the need for training, because then designers, contractors say, you know, I want to be sure I can meet the requirements. So for me also, a smart requirement environment can be a major driver for training. Mm-hmm. So it is sometimes focusing on training. Sometimes if you put clear requirements, you don't have as a government to oblige training. Take, for example, ventilation systems. If you focus on you have to deliver the good airflow rates, however you do it, it's clear that designers, installers will become motivated if there is good training to follow it. Because they know if I don't meet the airflow rate, if I don't meet the acoustical performance, I run into problems. So you don't have in that case to oblige training and to have certification of installers, no. If you say I focus on the end result, it can work. So it depends.
There should be some control afterwards,
yes,
otherwise.
You have always to think of what is the lightest way to get your objective. And if you then can have architects, contractors, investors as your partner, I think there is a chance you can go forward. But it's not evident. Yeah. It's clear that...
And especially for new buildings, for new dwellings, there we would expect that compliance would be higher because with more follow-up from designers, architects, and so on in the whole value chain. And even there we have seen that there are so many dysfunctions.
Yeah, because take again the example of ventilation, but you could do for other technologies. If you are in a situation where at the end of the chain, the owner, the architect, the building promoter is not able or not sufficiently motivated to check if the performance is met, mm-hmm. Okay, you have in a difficult situation, but because it's clear for ventilation, as an example, to do it correctly will cost something more. Yeah. And as you know, the margins are not always very high, so if you know that with the lower quality or no quality, the work will be accepted, you have to be strong to deliver good quality. I know a number of installers who told me, you don't have to convince me to invest in training, I know what I have to do. But sometimes I don't do it because if I do what I have to do, I am too expensive. So, but that's case by case. So in the case of thermal breaches and mold grow, I think if you are as an architect, as a contractor aware of the problem, you will do it correctly. Because you know, if I start to cheat, I may have big liability issues.
Okay, thank you. Are there further questions? Yeah. And then we go for a coffee break.
Ja, Hans Erhorn. Peter, you mentioned or you showed all the influence on the quality check procedure. Can you tell me why it is not able to integrate it in the EPBD next version? So I didn't find any words about this in the extension of the EPBD. What we have to do?
I don't think that the EPBD blocks it. There is indeed no explicit specification in the EPBD that member states should install procedures which result in good quality of the works. But we see in a number of countries that there are requirements which in practice stimulate, let's say, good quality of the works. If I look, for example, to my own country, for ventilation systems since 2016 in the Flemish region, you have to prove in the framework of third-party control what are the airflow rates you achieve. There is no obligation to be a certified designer or installer, but there is a very, I would say, strict environment. What you declare as airflow rate should indeed be done. And in that way, I think that you are not really putting a lot of requirements on the installers, but if you want, as an installer, as a designer, to be sure that you achieve what is specified, you create a market for training for good workmanship. So it's clear that the directive, I think, could have been gone further by imposing that member states really set up procedures to deliver good quality of the works. It's a pity it's not there. But on the other hand, it's not because it's not there that member states should not do it. I think they have all the liberty to do it. But again, it's a question of awareness raising, motivating the stakeholders. It might be in their benefit to have this kind of checks.
Okay. Thank you. There is nobody from DG Energy yet, I guess. Otherwise, some recommendations to improve the EPBD. So thank you, Peter. So we are coming back within 15-20 minutes for the second half of this afternoon. Thank you.